audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
3, 2, 1, go.
Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number.
Forget about the phone number.
That's right. Dr. Drew, board-certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Drew, why do we need to forget about the phone number?
Because this is our favorite kind of LoveLine show.
Mm-hmm.
Because?
We're not here.
That's right. We're not physically here. I mean, we're here
spiritually.
Spiritually. Our thoughts are with you.
And this is a best-of show that is does not have a guest in it. Now, normally we take good guests and put them on the show. But in this case,
this is
all the best calls.
And it's our favorite guest, too. The love that constantly exudes between us.
That's right. Yeah. So enjoy. Good times, everybody. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. All right. Let's talk to Jay, who's 29. Jay?
Yes, I'm Jay. And my question's about my girlfriend. She's recently aborted our child, and she says it's because she had suppressed memories from her brother molesting her when she was younger.
What does that have to do with aborting a child?
She claimed that she thought that the child would be molested by her current son, who he's about 3. She was afraid that as they grew up, that eventually that would happen. It would repeat itself.
Has that child been abused by an adult?
No, the child's never been abused. No, I've helped her raise the child for 2 years.
Yeah, well, she's just, Drew, there's nothing rational. Did she go out and get an abortion?
I told her I didn't support that at all, and I told her I wanted to get married.
Right. And she went out and got an abortion.
She went out and got an abortion, and she said it was because she had these memories that came back all of a sudden. She didn't.
Yeah.
She didn't know where it came from, and at the same time, I knew this brother, and I had Christmas dinner with him, and I took his kid out to trick or treat, and I can't believe it. And I think it's just because she doesn't want to be with me that she made this story up.
Doesn't want to be with you?
Well. Because I got more serious when I heard that she was pregnant.
Drew, the way you worded that is like you were in love with Jay, too. And you couldn't imagine anybody not being in love with Jay.
It was more like
you drop your wife and run away with Jay in a second.
A little bit of how dare you. This poor woman is having these repressed memories and you make it all about you.
Well, I mean, the guy's a little bit angry and a little bit hurt about
the
fact that she aborted his child. So I'm with him on that one, Drew. And, you know, Jay's probably not a psychology major. I mean, it's hard to read this guy.
Yeah.
And not you, Jay, but I mean the brother. The brother could have molested her and then went on to sort of seem very normal. Mm-hmm. It's not like you get a windbreaker when you molest people that says, you know, kiss me, I've molested.
And if it really is a repressed memory, sometimes they can be confusing or distorted, and it can be sort of blamed on someone, and in fact, somebody else was the perpetrator. So.
Any way you slice it, though, Jay, your girlfriend is a handful.
Yeah.
There's issues, big time.
I've gotten really involved because I've been with her for 2 years and I've gotten really attached to her son, but I don't think I should just stay in the situation because I'm attached to her son.
Well, I
think you should.
Well,
frankly.
But here's the thing, Jay. This woman is probably fairly chaotic, your girlfriend, that is.
But she wasn't before she got pregnant.
Well,
you just didn't see it.
She has a son that you sort of raised as your own when the child was of 1 year of age.
Yes.
That's chaotic.
Yeah.
I mean, unless the guy died a hero in Desert Storm.
No, he didn't. He was never on the scene.
Right.
Okay. So
that's not
crazy chaos by today's standards. But when you have a 1 year old and no daddy around, that's a little bit. There's a little energy there. There's a little something going on.
Yeah.
Then you come in and pick up the pieces, and she kind of pulls this one now.
Now, somebody that though has she sort of had a-hole boyfriends all along until you?
The last guy. The reason why she left him was that when she got pregnant, she found out that he had another girl pregnant, and that's why that didn't work out.
All right. See, she's going for these a-holes up until now.
Right.
Well, and I wouldn't like to think that.
Well, that's what happens is women that tend to go for those kinds of guys are acting something out. And when they get with a nice guy who's genuinely available, it freaks them out, and they inadvertently sabotage the relationship.
All right, so Jay.
I mean, I don't want to make it, it's all about me, but
Jay.
She kept the child from a man that was an a-hole, and
yeah.
And then I tried to be the good guy.
Here we go, Adam.
Yeah. Hey, Drew, remember the speech I gave last night about all you crazy effed up goddamn broads?
Yep.
Given plenty of sex, no blame and no responsibility to the a-hole guys, and mm-hmm. beating the crap out of the nice guys that are trying to make a go of the family.
Yep.
This is just more of that.
This is that, but she's really flipped out by intimacy. She can't tolerate
yes.
it.
Yes. Okay, Jay.
Yeah.
Listen to me good.
Yes.
You are not equipped emotionally to deal with a chick like this, because this chick is a handful, and she's a mess, and she got scrambled a little bit. This is going to be a tough, tough job for you. If you love the child, that's great. I respect that. Mm-hmm. And if you want to make a go at it with her, she's going to have to get a little therapy. Because if this is true, I mean, you can say to her, listen, I'm not blaming you for the abortion. I understand you were molested by your brother. But if in fact this is all true, then you need some therapy.
Right.
Because you will screw up this kid.
Yeah.
Okay. That's it. She's got to get therapy. And Jay, if she gets kooky, you got to just walk.
Okay.
All right. The part that breaks my heart is the two-year-old.
Yeah. See, I wouldn't give him the just walk recommendation. I would say hang in on behalf of that kid until the kid's at least 8 or 10. And, I mean, that kid needs a steady relationship for a long time.
Well, was it a boy?
Yeah.
Oh, then stay in, because I don't want him to stab me. If it was a chick, I say move on. She'll be a stripper, a porn star. Society will be that much richer. Regina?
Yeah?
You're 14?
Uh-huh.
What's up?
I wanted to know if putting, like, absorbing hairspray kind of like in through my skin, is it like, would it give me the same effects if I huffed it?
No.
What if you just put the can up your ass,
just shut it off in there?
Yeah,
explode it.
Yeah.
Well, what's going on here, Drew, Regina? What is going on?
You're hoofing hairspray?
No. Okay, I've been cutting myself for about, like, a year.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, 2 weeks ago or something, I just, after I did it, I kind of rubbed hairspray into it.
Mm-hmm. Why? Why?
I don't know.
What kind of hairspray?
Like, Vidal Sassoon or something. Ooh. Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it kind of, like, I don't know, it didn't really hurt, but it just, I kind of got, like, this rush, mm-hmm. and, like, a couple, you know, like, right now, they're kind of, the scars
yeah.
are kind of healing over, and they're all, like, purple and puffy,
mm-hmm.
and it looks, like, cool, and I wanted to know if, like because it's in me.
No. Regina, who is treating you for your behaviors?
Huh?
What's going on here? Who's treating you for this cutting?
Nobody.
Okay, you got to do that. It's not cool to have big scars, big keloid scars on your forearms. Not cool. It's not good for you to put hydrocarbons into your soft tissue. Okay, this is really over the top inappropriate behavior.
Okay.
Yeah,
yeah. Well,
and to be
what's
thinking
up?
It's cool.
What's up with you?
You're
mad at your parents?
Yeah, I guess so.
What are they doing? They make money?
Sure.
I mean, what do they do for a living? I know you don't know what your dad does, but what's your mom
do? I know
what
my dad does.
What?
My dad's a blackjack dealer.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I guess that's specific. I guess you'd have to know that.
Yeah, my mom's, like, a secretary, I think.
Ooh. Okay. So your parents, they're busy. They don't pay attention to you?
Well, my mom she's really abusive, and...
What kind of abuse?
She just hits me.
Oh, she mm-hmm. does?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Still, maybe. at age 14.
Mm-hmm.
What is she, Mexican, Italian? What is she?
We're Asian.
Asian? Yeah. That explains the blackjack. Why are they so attracted to the card dealing, the Asians, Drew?
I don't know.
And one day I'm going to find out an answer to that. Is it the numbers?
You should. If your mom does that, you should call Child Protective Services, Regina. This is really damaging for you.
You know what drives me nuts, Drew? When I draw like the 6 and the 3, I got a 9, so I do the hit me, and the guy keeps flipping the cards, and then I bust, and he starts gathering the cards, and I haven't done the math yet, and I'm not sure where I'm at. For all I know, this guy's giving me the shiv, you know, maybe I got 21, maybe I got 20s, but he flipped 6 cards so fast and did the goddamn math so fast, and he's collecting them all.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm always too embarrassed to go, wait a minute, hold on, Hop Sing, not so fast.
You're dictating your fingers one.
Trying to screw the round eye again. Yeah, one Mississippi. Hold on, I got to take my shoes off. I'm out of digits. Oh, okay. You win this time. Okay. So, listen, Regina, you got to call the Child Protective Services if your mom's beating on you.
Well...
Well,
it's been going on since I was, like, really little, and...
Yeah, but it's making you cut on yourself now, and you're screwing yourself up.
Things are
like,
a mess now.
About getting help or whatever. It's not like I do it, like, deep enough to...
It doesn't matter. You're having it. You're in pain.
I know why I do it, so...
Why? Why do you do it?
Because of, like, I just had lots of problems. Like, when I was 8 until I was 10... From 8 to 10, my uncle just, like, touched me and stuff. And then...
Does anybody in the family know about that?
No.
No?
No,
all right, so there's another thing you got going here.
All right, listen, sweet pie. How are you doing in school?
I'm good in school, actually.
You are?
Yeah.
See, that's that Asian gene. All right, listen now, baby. You got to take care of yourself. Bad things have been done to you. I'm sorry to hear that. But that doesn't mean you're bad and doesn't mean you should do bad things to you. You're a smart person. You sound a lot sharper than most our callers. You're doing good in school. You got to really get it together for the next few years, get through high school and go off to college and leave this mess far behind. And I know it's not going to be easy, but it's going to be that much harder if you're cutting on yourself and screwing with yourself. Do you have friends? Do you have things you like to do? Do you have interests? I mean, you got to focus hard on pursuing everything that's sort of positive and doesn't involve hurting you. And in the meantime, you got to talk to a counselor at school and throw yourself on their mercy.
You really do, Regina.
You know what was funny, Drew?
Huh.
You know I don't like to stereotype.
Oh, yeah, that's not you.
That's not
no
my style.
Not your style at all.
No. But you know how the stereotypes very rarely disappoint?
Yeah.
I played pool today with a the woman they call the Black Widow. She's a very, very attractive Asian woman who was like ranked number one in women's pool for many a year. She's still a young woman, and she's, I think, ranked number 4 now. Have you seen this woman?
No.
And I don't expect you have, Drew, because you've seen nothing ever.
Right. Right.
If I said there's this round orb that comes out at night, it hovers over the midnight sky, we call it the moon. Have you seen this, Drew? Oh,
No.
Now you'd say, now I've seen the 76 ball. Is that what you're talking? No. This is sometimes it's full, other times what they call crescent. No,
I've heard talk of this moon, but I've never seen the
right. Yeah.
Sphere. Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I'm positive. If I brought that up some years ago, that would have been your response. But this woman is a attractive, long-legged Asian woman who dresses in black and shoots pool like she's the best in the world. Huh. And she's kind of hot. And they call her the Black Widow. And it's kind of thing where you're flipping through the channels, you see it on ESPN2 late at night, and she's wearing her silky black outfit and beating the crap out of everybody. But still, the stereotype doesn't work. Asian woman hustling pool doesn't seem right. You know what I'm saying?
So what happened?
I said to her, I said I was a little bit confused, and but obviously she was ranked number one when she was like 21 years old, and if you're going to be ranked number one in the world shooting pool, well then it stands to reason you start playing at 7, right?
Right,
and you had a pool table in your house, yet that does not gel with the Asian stereotype at all. So I said to her, now when did you start playing pool? And she said, I snuck out of the house and started playing at 18. And I was like, well, snuck 18. Out of the house. Yes. My parents made me play the piano for about 10. And I thought, yes.
Violin for 3
it's
years.
It's all coming together now. Now this is perfect. Of course you didn't have a pool table in your house. Of course you had a piano in your house. Even though you're the number one female pool player in the world, because you're Asian, the stereotype trumps even the number one ranking, and you must have a piano in your house and not a pool table. Do you see how right the stereotype is, that it can almost never be foiled, that even someone who's number one at 21 didn't have a pool table because she was Asian?
In 3 years, she became the best in the world?
Apparently. Well, wow. I guess when you have a gift for something. But wow. Yes, but see, Drew, the stereotype trumps all. Trumps all. Every time. What Asian family has a pool table? But yet, how do you get around it? She must have had a pool table. She's number one. Nope, a piano. That's all you need to know. All right.
All right.
Yeah. And listen, people say all the time, stop stereotyping. But my thing is, like, how do I get to the truth if I don't stereotype? I'll never know what's going on.
Amanda.
I would have been wrong and thought she had a pool table in her house growing up. You see, I would have been wrong. If I didn't stereotype, I would have been wrong.
Do I get to the truth if I don't?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
You know what I'd like to do, Drew?
Yeah.
I would like to, one day, I would like to recreate everything I say in Italian. And then I would like to play it next to some of Mussolini's speeches and see if it's close. I think a lot of it would sound close. What do you think?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Hey, Amanda.
Yeah?
Turn down whatever you got to turn down or do whatever off. You got to do.
Okay, it's down, it's off.
Even in German, by Hitler, I'm sure it would be the same thing.
Yeah, right? He was probably talking about Asian shooting pool that whole time. I don't know. When he was up on the pulpit and he was making a fist and pounding on it, he could have been talking about Asians and pianos. We don't know. Maybe even the heated sofa. I'd like to. They never do really translate, though. So, how do we know he was sending a negative message? He could have.
Now you're scaring me.
Well, I'm just saying he could have been saying like the half track and parking lot C has its lights on. I mean, maybe he was making a PSA announcement. He could have been talking about what they were going to eat. I don't know what he was saying. That's my point. Let's not rush your judgment. That's all I'm saying. Okay, we'll take ourselves a little break. We'll be right back.
LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Hey, everybody. It's LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. He's in Washington, D.C. And phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Yeah. I was just talking to phone screener Brian, and the Sherpas are from Tibet.
Oh, Tibet, okay.
Yeah, and I was saying Nepal, but then I know Mount Everest is in between Tibet and maybe something. Nepal. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Well, see, I'm not there to just pick up the dictionary and look it up.
Yeah, what would you look up, though?
I can go on the web and look it up.
All just right, genius.
Look up, you know.
Don't got a computer
Everest.
Where you are?
I'll do it.
Yeah, do that, would you?
Yeah, but then you'll start yelling at me for not concentrating.
Nah, go ahead.
All right.
Go ahead and do it now.
You talk to Amanda in the meantime.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Hello?
Amanda, I say Mount Everest, 26,332 feet.
Nope.
Lucas, you're 14. What's up?
Okay. My mom's been taking these pills, and I'm really worried about her.
What pills?
She takes just, like, sleeping pills and... She's been taking, she tells me she's taking, Valiums.
She's been doing this for a long time?
She has, but I've just been recently noticing she's been getting really stoned and stuff off of it for the past, like, couple weeks.
Does she become unconscious?
No, not really. She just kind of, like...
Where's your dad?
What?
Where's your dad?
I never know him.
Is she doing this during the day?
She gets home from work and she does it. I tell her she should just do it when she just goes to bed, so she doesn't have.
You didn't call recently and tell us the same story?
Huh?
No. Remember the story?
Yeah, I thought it was that day. True. Why'd you screw with me? this is why. See, I wear the same clothes every day, so when I just sort of look down, I'm not sure what day it is.
I remember the kid called and said she gets home from work. She says she's stressed, takes a fistful of Valium and Soma.
Right.
Sort of goes out.
Right. And I was telling him, also, leave her alone and get the hell out of the house.
Yeah.
Lucas?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we'll give the same advice to you as we gave to the other kid, which is talk to your mom and tell her this is
it's bothering
you, and if she could explain it to you. She might explain it, and it might make it better.
No.
I just mean we're getting Lucas's version of the story.
Yeah, all right.
I mean, it would be marginally better.
Maybe.
If she explained it. And see if she can't take these pills later on in the evening when you're safely in your room beating off.
Or not. Oh, Lucas chimes in with you.
Yeah.
Or not at all. Maybe she should take it now. And if she needs some help, I think one of the things you have a right to do is call social services. You know, you've got a parent, you have a single
14.
Parent, you're out of control. She's
out of control. She's napping. He gets control of the TV.
Yeah.
Are you kidding? Don't you wish your parents would have gotten themselves a little bit loaded and just passed out, and you just sit there and watch TV and do your homework and go to bed?
Yeah, when you're 14, and he's
14.
Obviously very codependent on the mom. And
all right.
It's damaging to him.
Lucas, you got friends?
Yeah.
All right, hang out with them.
Hi.
And, talk to your mom. Let her explain it. But if she doesn't explain it well, tell her she's got to get some help.
Yeah. Well, this is addiction.
Could be, yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Soma Valley, I should never be taken together anyway.
Really?
Oh, man, that's crazy. Soma, I'm seeing a lot of Soma addiction lately.
I just heard Take It Together.
You just heard Try This.
Yeah, I don't hear the never Taken Together. I hear Taken Together.
Okay, I'm drinking a lot of Soma lately, interestingly, and there's a real characteristic withdrawal people get into where they get this tightening up in their back and this arm pain where they feel like they want to twitch the arm and punch things.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, they get like a restless limb in their upper extremity.
Hmm.
And they get this agitation where they can't stop moving.
What is
Soma? They're constantly moving. It's a muscle relaxant, but it's actually converted to meprobamate, which is an old-fashioned.
Sure.
Miltown. Ever heard of Miltown?
Sure. Great.
Converted by, it's
great
Miltown.
Band from the mid...
Yeah, it's sort of like something that...
No, I don't know.
Mickey Finn?
Amanda?
Yeah?
All right, so you're 14.
Yeah.
You get spontaneous orgasms during the day.
Yeah.
Start.
And I don't even know why. Nothing's there to turn me on or anything. It just happens. I don't know where.
Are you on any medication?
No.
And does it, let's see. Do you know what an orgasm is? Have you ever had one with a guy?
Yeah.
You have?
Yeah.
14, had an orgasm with a guy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So see, girls that they have it, it's like, yeah, what are you talking about? Of course.
Of course.
How could I not?
Okay.
They fall right out of me.
And it feels the same?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, she's one of those types. That's the, again, the spectrum of the female.
That's a nice little perk. Are you a virgin?
Yeah.
How did you have the orgasm with the guy? Or he was just around during the time you had it when you were just standing around?
No, we were just messing around.
Wow. You got an older sister from me? Not too much older, just like 6 months?
Oh, just think how that could add to your laziness.
I mean, yeah, because while it's raining orgasms over at Amanda's place, I can't get an orgasm out of a woman with a flat bar and a single jerk.
But I'm really...
You know what a single jerk is, Drew?
No, it's like you pull your...
Mini sledgehammer. Mini sledge.
All right, 29,028 feet. You ready?
29,000.
Yeah.
Wow. All right, boy, that's a high peak.
But like you'll 26. Be happy to know it lies on the border between Nepal and Tibet.
Good times.
Good
I'll
times.
Tell you, me and phone screener Brian, what a team we would make tooling around in his bench-seated, beat-up S10 pickup truck, drinking a sixer at the park, cruising chicks. Oh, yeah.
Talking about trivia.
Amanda?
Yeah?
Hey, baby. All right, so you're
happy. Is she burping?
She burped. You're all class. So you're
everything falls out of her.
You're having yourself an orgasm. That's
burps,
fine.
Orgasms, whatever.
That's just you, baby.
Is there anything wrong with me?
No.
Were you doing? Were you exercising or anything when it happened?
No.
Then you're fine.
No, some women are just have that capacity that they can, you know, just tighten the muscles down there and pow.
All right.
Others, we talked to somebody earlier this evening. She couldn't pry it out.
No. Let's talk to, who are we talking to?
Aaron.
Aaron.
Yes, sir.
You're 22.
Yes, sir.
What's up?
I've been in a relationship for about two and a half years. You know, about 6 months into the relationship, I don't know what happened, but I started not being able to get, like, an erection. whenever I wanted to. Before that, I could get an erection, like easy.
Before, what do they do now, tell me? They removed a testicle?
Yeah, they removed a testicle and that.
Why?
When I was
Why?
16.
Why?
Because I guess it got twisted and it was born with a piece of skin that attaches to your scrotum or whatever.
Right, it got a torsion. And so it twists and dies, basically. That's pretty painful, huh?
Yeah, it was. It's a long story, huh?
Well, tell people about it, because it's actually an important thing for people to know how to sort of recognize.
Okay, well, I was sitting there with my cousin up in this bedroom watching TV, and it'd go away periodically. I mean, sometimes it would throb, then it would go away before that, and sometimes it'd really hurt, and then it'd go away. But this time it just kept on hurting and hurting and hurting. I figured it'd go away if I shipped it or moved, you know, because sometimes it'd go away if I did that. But this time my cousin thought I was being a dummy. I just started curling up on the floor, you know, and then finally I figured, man, I got to go to the hospital. It just hurt so bad.
But right. Now, there's nothing about the removal of that testy that should affect your...
I tell you, Drew, this Aaron should cut a PSA for this.
Yeah, again, another just glorious, colorful images.
Actually, well, I think it makes me perform better now. I mean, it used to anyways, but...
But you're having trouble...
Because I can go a little longer, I thought, but... But now I think it's me. Have I lost interest? I mean, because sometimes if I can rejuvenate, you know what I'm saying, take a break.
Right.
And then after three, I can go for like 3 days perfectly normal. Then I'll just lose interest again, maybe rejuvenate another 3 days and go again like normal.
Hold on.
That just seems odd to me.
Yeah. You have, well, have one woman you're rejuvenating with, Aaron?
Yes.
Okay. Mm. Didn't sound thrilled about that.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, yeah. Are you in love?
See, that's the thing, too. I think I'm just losing interest.
Yeah. Oh,
okay. All right.
You don't sound like you're ready to break out into song about this young lady. would that be?
Like, you had a caller earlier, and who was kind of messed up and had this guy had a kid with her or something. And,
right, right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and she's a bipolar manic depressant, mm-hmm. and she takes Escalift.
Do you take any medications?
I don't take anything.
All right, so your old lady's a handful.
Yeah, and I've been trying to, you know, I loved her in the beginning, and I just wanted to help her out. I think that's why been here so long.
Right. Well, how long, you're 22, how long you been with her?
2 years, about 3 months.
Okay. Well, and
you got to be honest about this and maybe
does she? Yeah.
Here.
Does she have a kid?
No, but she's a compulsive liar, too.
All right. All right. Listen.
And she said...
All right. That's enough. Listen.
Yeah, that's a problem.
You don't need to talk to us to know you need to break up with someone. And Drew.
Yeah.
I know this. I feel this way, and I, you know, whenever you feel something, it's like a food you really like,
mm-hmm.
and when you realize that someone else doesn't like lasagna
or
cashews or something like that, you get pissed off.
Yeah,
that's the way I feel about relationships. Isn't it better to be alone than to be with a serious handful? I mean,
but you gotta remember, a lot of people need that. They seek that out.
I know chicks like need projects. That, but the guys need that too.
Some guys are very codependent. And I'll tell you, let me just finish with Aaron, though. It sounds like there has been a real change in his performance that maybe not just because of the lack of enthusiasm about the relationship. He ought to get checked out just in case there's something wrong with the testosterone production in that one remaining testing. Or maybe a thyroid problem or a prolactin screen tumor or something else affecting his overall biology.
Yeah.
Yeah. A second.
Hey, Drew. Let me ask you a question.
What?
Both my hands,
Uh-oh.
The palms of my hands.
Yeah.
Right about the middle of the palm of my hands are mm-hmm. producing tumors or lumps or something. You know. Remember the one I had in my palm?
Yeah. Yep.
These are in the middle of my hands.
Mm.
They're getting more pronounced, and they're right in the middle of the palm of my hand, and they're on both hands now.
Let me look at it. Usually those are synovial cysts.
What is that coming from?
They're coming from the sheaths that surround the tendons that go out to your fingers.
Yeah.
The particular ones that cause your fingers to move forward, to flex.
Really? Yeah, this is on the underside, and it's about an inch back from where my fingers attach to my palm.
Yeah. Yeah, and it moves when you open and close your fingers, right?
I guess, not really. Not it feels really. Like a little BB's under there, but it's on both hands now.
Is it the fourth finger only?
Let's see. No. One of them's in the middle, and the other one's off toward the pinky side.
You may be getting what are called Dupuytren's contractures.
Well, yeah, that's what I thought initially. Old Dupuytren's has reared its ugly head, but why both hands and why sort of at the same time?
Because that tends to be the way that develops. And at a certain age. Your dad have this? The sort of shortening is fourth and fifth fingers kind of contracted down a little bit?
No. Yeah. No, is this a boxing thing, though?
Not that I'm aware of.
Why the palms of both hands,
though? Let me look at it.
All right, well, could you fly back tonight? I'm worried.
Jesus Christ.
Justin?
Come on, like,
yeah?
You're 13?
Yeah.
What's up there, buddy?
Hey, I think you should do the publicity stunt.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
And I have a question for Drew.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, is it possible for, like, real life, dog sperm cells to, like, if we could inject them into, like, some lady's egg cells and could make, like, a baby out of that? Like,
no, you can't can't mix across species.
All right.
Sorry. No dog baby.
God willing. God willing, one day, though, Justin.
Yeah.
We'll be able to do that.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Interbreed.
Yeah. Yeah. What would you mix, Justin?
Like a wolf or something. Like a werewolf.
You go wolf human?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wolfy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, thanks.
Yeah, all right.
Good times, right?
Good times, yeah.
Yeah. I'd do like a giraffe and a catfish.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good eating.
Oh, yeah.
No, that's better. I'd probably like take my two favorite foods. I would take like a cow and like a linguine. Or is that a pasta?
Yeah, linguine. I'm not sure that's a specie.
Oh. Well, you know what I'd do? I'd take a cow and an asparagus.
Ooh, yeah.
That wouldn't work either.
Plant nail.
I would take a cow and a ribs.
Yeah.
Now, you know what I would?
Your favorite food would just cross it with a rhinoceros. You get more of it.
Yeah, but rhino can be tough. I'd take a cow and a pig.
All right. There you go.
And make a kid.
A pow.
That's right. I would write this down, Drew.
I'm writing it.
Cow and pig and make a pow. And you'd have, you know, cause sometimes you go out for ribs and it's like, you want the beef or you want the baby back pork. Yeah. And you're like, I don't know, man. I don't know. And they're like, well, what's it going to be? And you're like, I mean, the baby backs are succulent, but the beef ribs so much bigger. And then the guy starts yelling at you, and he's like, make a decision. He starts yelling, mow! And you're like, I don't know. And this, now, you know, pow.
Pow.
Give me the pow. Give me a large rack of the pow. That would be good. And listen, Drew, can't we do this now? I mean, well... We got the nectarine. Oh. You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, that's like a peach and a plum or something, right?
Yeah.
Or tangerine and a peach. Or, I mean, if we can make the nectarine, I don't think the nectarine existed 100 years ago.
If we can make a nectarine, certainly we can make a pow.
We made boysenberries out of, I think, I don't know, blackberries and blueberries or something like that. Knott's did the boysenberry.
Is that right?
Yeah, not Knott's Berry Farm, Don Knott's.
Oh, okay.
No, Knott's Berry Farm did that. I'm just saying, whoever's listening, is some geneticist or something, start working on that pow. I could go for that. Eat them ribs.
You just sit back and think about the pow while we take a break.
All right.
Hello, this is your radio. LoveLine will be right back. On 100.5, The Zone. Welcome back to LoveLine with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
I think it's great. We keep listening.
On 100.5, The Zone.
Hey, everybody. LoveLine. Hey, Drew.
You.
Just spent the last 10 minutes trying to hammer out what Knott's from Knott's Berry Farm invented. Decided he crossed the blackberry with the raspberry, creating the boysenberry.
Oh, interesting.
That's where we left off.
I see. Well, I'll look it up on the web. You want me to?
Yeah.
Here we go.
Joe?
Yeah.
You're 20. What's up?
Yeah. My girlfriend, she's 21. We've been together for just over 3 years now. And, like, 2 weeks ago, she started, like, bitching about, like, if we get out of the car and we start walking somewhere, if I walk a little in front of her, if I walk through a door before her, or, like, if I'm ever in front of her, she's, like, bitching about it being disrespectful. And it doesn't happen all the time, but, I mean, I never think about it.
How long has she been your girlfriend?
Just over 3 years.
3 years. And how long has she been complaining like this?
Like 2 weeks.
3.5.
Is some of this sort of, is she from Atlanta? Is she from the South?
Yeah.
Is some of this sort of her expectation, you know, of her upbringing, that women be treated
a certain
way?
Well, I don't know, but why the hell didn't it come out earlier than this?
It's interesting.
All of a sudden.
I don't know. Do we care? He's walking in front of her.
She's angry about something.
Yes.
Everything you do, she's angry and irritable about. Now, either she's getting depressed about something, maybe she's on a new birth control pill or having some medications affecting her, or something's going on in this relationship.
Have a chat with her, not about who's walking through the door first, but about what's going on in general. Don't attack her. Just have a chat about it.
All right. The boysenberry was developed in the early 1920s by Rudolph Boysen of Napa, California. Considered along with the Loganberry and the Youngberry, a variety of blackberry.
What the hell that Knott's of Knott's Berry Farm did?
They're just canned stuff.
Well, maybe he got hold of this thing and kind of claimed it as his own or something, because that would have been right about the right time period in the 20s. All I'm saying is, come on, if they could do this, we're up to mating the pig and the cow. That's all. That's all I'm saying.
Ooh.
Yeah. People's thing is like, nah, we can't do that. We don't want to play God. But I say, if you can pull God off, do it. You want to take another call here, Drew?
I'm still quickly going through the knots.
All right, go ahead. I'll take a call.
All right.
Chris?
Boysenberry pies?
Mmm.
Mmm, donuts.
Chris?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. You're 16. What's up?
Huh?
All right.
Whoa.
That's about an average caller.
Oh.
Tim?
Yeah, how you guys doing?
Good. You're 17. You want to know if Paxil's increasing your tolerance to opiates?
Yeah.
You take opiates for fun?
Yeah.
What kind of opiates do you take?
Buena Park is well known as the home of the boysenberry. Wait a minute.
This show's great. You know what this show's like? You know, when you're a kid and you wanted to stay up longer, you thought you could, like, distract your parents by telling them to watch something or engage them or talk to them or something. This is what I do with Drew. I distract him so that I really get Drew to prioritize by looking up who invented boysenberries while people are ODing on the other line.
Yeah. Buena Park has been well known as the home of the boysenberry, which was created by Rudolph Boysen and Walter Knott, together with blackberry, red raspberry, and loganberry.
Now, Drew, doesn't this reinforce one more time that I'm never wrong?
Never.
About anything?
It's kind of freaking me out, in fact.
Yeah, it's even when you look something up and it doesn't have my guy's name on it, you got to find another source. Thank you. Woo! All right. And go back the phones, man?
Huh?
Wow! You want to break away from this party long enough to help some kids?
Yeah.
All right, let's break away, and then we'll come back to the party, all right?
Okay.
Hey, yeah! Jimmy.
Yeah.
What up?
19, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been dating a girl for about 5 months.
Yeah.
We've been having intercourse for about 4 months.
Oh, yeah.
But she's kind of got a problem. She has no feeling inside.
Whoa.
What do you mean, no feeling inside?
Like,
she's got not in her guts, man. She's got no emotion.
Well, she said it just feels like pressure. That's about it. I mean, as far as actual feeling in her vagina, I guess.
Whoa.
I mean, she has feeling on the outside.
Yeah. Drew, do you have any feeling inside your vagina?
Not much.
No, I don't. I have almost none.
And
what is it you expect? Have you had a sex with someone else in the past?
Yeah.
And how did that go?
Well, I mean, it went real good.
Okay, so this is your second partner, right?
No, third.
Third.
Yeah.
And this one doesn't get aroused?
Well, she does. That's the deal. She does.
Yeah, but she doesn't have a climax.
Right. She can almost get to the breaking point, I guess.
All right, well, most 19-year-old women do not have a climax during intercourse. The significant majority do not.
Yeah.
So there's nothing wrong with her. Do you understand that?
Okay. So, I mean, what do I do?
Well, Ace has the solution. Hold on.
Everything.
Man, you got to give her the velvet buzzsaw, dude. That's my move, man.
What?
The velvet buzzsaw. A little.
I've done everything.
Yeah, man. But you can't go down there with such a sense of urgency, man. You got to hang loose. You know what I'm saying, Brian?
It's time to give the cat and dog analogy.
Huh? Okay. All right. I haven't given this one in a while.
It's a good one.
Yeah, I have many good ones for you.
I know.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Too bad you can't remember them. It reminds you of what they are.
I know. Thank you. But everyone should write this down. Women are essentially cats. And men are dogs. And dogs like it very different than cats like it. And I don't mean sex.
Everything.
But I mean...
life.
You see a dog, what do? You grab it, you pull its ears, you knock it down, you get it in a headlock, you rub its belly.
Pound on its side.
You pound on it. Yeah. It likes that. I mean, you know, you can do this... like
tails wagging.
You can do a thing where you make it... My friend Chris has himself a black lab that's about 30 pounds overweight. You know, it's like a 110-pound dog. And it comes running up to the car, and its tail is so big and so fat and wagging so hard that it's hitting my car fender, and it sounds like someone's taking a hammer. It's just like, bonk. It's reverberating through the car. Doink, 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 doink. I thought like I blew a tire or something. Murphy. I take my knuckle. I put my knuckle right between Murphy's eyes on the bridge. And then just start grinding it on it. Murphy starts pushing back with his head, and then I tackle him. You know, he's into it. That's what dogs like.
Yeah.
Now, you try that on a cat, what do you get?
Your ass scratched off.
Yeah, you get detached retina. That's what you get. Tim.
Yeah.
You're on the Paxil.
Right.
And you're taking the drugs, too.
Right.
So you should stop taking the drugs because you're already on the Paxil, which suggests that you have some problems and that you're trying to take care of those problems. And now you're kind of compounding those problems by getting into the drugs.
Well, I've been into drugs for a while.
Okay. Has anybody treated your drug addiction?
Nope.
All right, well, that's why you're depressed. You're a drug addict. Right. Drug addicts are always depressed.
Well, actually, I'm taking a pack for social and generalized anxiety disorders. Right,
but none of that, any psychiatric symptoms you have when you're doing drugs are sort of uninterpretable. It doesn't matter. I mean, anything under the sun can be happening when you're doing drugs. You've got to get the drug addiction treated. The rule of thumb is you wait at least 3 months to treat psychiatric symptoms until somebody's well engaged in treatment.
All right, I want to talk to young Justin, who's from Oklahoma, 15. You can't get the balls to ask out an older girl at school.
Well, she's not really older. She's like a couple months older than I am.
She's one of the popular girls.
Huh?
Did you describe her to one of our phone screeners as older?
She's in the higher grade than me.
I see.
All right.
You know, it kind of dawns on me that I'm kind of stupid for being in a lower grade than her, and I don't really want to ask her out because of it.
What grade are you in?
I'm going into 10th grade this year.
Yeah, that's fine. No. You're 15.
Yeah.
All right. Well, here's the deal, Justin.
Do you think you have a chance?
Well, like, she kind of talks to me and whatnot, but...
Uh-oh.
She talks to you telepathically, or she actually moves her lips? Because I believe there are girls communicating with me, but that was different.
Yeah, it's not like one of them.
Does she have a boyfriend?
Huh?
Does she have a boyfriend?
No, she was going out with this senior last year.
Mm.
But me and this senior didn't really get along. It was kind of a faggot, like an ape. Mm-hmm. So
the girls I would communicate with telepathically would command me to rape, Drew.
Mm. Good times.
Yeah. Interesting defense from a legal standpoint.
Mm-hmm. It's like Son of Sam.
Yeah. So anyway, I cut Justin off because he said her ex-boyfriend was a faggot who walked like an ape. Yeah. And although I don't mind that kind of talk on this show, it just sort of seemed to come from nowhere, and it was kind of weird.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Did you kind of get that vibe there, Drew?
Yeah, yes.
So, here's the deal, Justin. We don't care. I don't care if the girl goes out with you or doesn't go out with you.
But go ahead and ask.
I don't know. I don't like Justin.
Okay.
Don't ask. You should live. And not only that, Justin, with this girl, but for your whole life. Never ask. Never dare.
His head should grow on the ground, and he should grow up like an onion.
Grow like an onion.
Yeah.
They'll take a, oh boy, could I go for some boysenberry pie right now. Big clump of ice cream. You know what I do, Drew? I give it a shot in the microwave. Just a shot, about 33, 34 seconds in the microwave, and then pow, with the vanilla Haagen-Dazs.
Ooh.
Yeah, and I start with a fork, and then I transition into a spoon. All right.
LoveLine, 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Hello there, LoveLine fans. This is Adam Carolla.
This is Dr. Drew. Stick around for more right here on 100.5 The Zone.
KZZO Sacramento.
You're listening to LoveLine.
LoveLine. Makes you feel all warm inside.
Oh, yeah.
That's
LoveLine on 100.5 The Zone.
Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
Someone pointed it out to me and was sort of laughing about me.
Yeah.
I was saying stuff like, me and Dr. Drew, we speak on the phone at night, and Dr. Drew and I this, and Dr. Drew, and they said, you got to call him Doctor? Call him Drew?
When I call you at the man show, I go, hey, it's Drew. Like, who's calling?
Well, that's what I told the people. I do it for clarification, not out of respect for Drew, but for you guys. If I say I'm just talking to Drew.
They won't know who you're talking about.
Right.
As it is, they don't know.
Yeah.
Right. So.
I'll tell you okay, for
what?
You know, my dad.
Yeah.
My dad, my friend Ray, has a friend named Drew.
Yeah.
Who I've met two or three times, and my dad has met two or three times. And one time when I was speaking about you, I said, I don't know, they want me and Drew to do some morning radio, but I don't know, Drew said that we got to sit it out, and I think we're going to do this. Drew and I are going to do a speaking engagement or whatever. My dad thought I was talking about Ray's friend.
You sure Brad doesn't? Your dad doesn't have some sort of neurological problem?
I wish he did. It'd be so much easier for me if he did. I pray to God he's got a tumor the size of a pumpkin growing in his head.
It'll make everything make sense, won't it?
Yeah, it'd be great. He's on vacation right now. Hey, Drew, let me ask you a hypothetical. My dad's on vacation. Who do you think's paying for that vacation?
The government?
No.
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 Himself?
No, no. Third option.
Shocking. Your sister.
Ooh, close, but no.
Adam Carolla.
That's right.
Oh,
that's
gosh.
Right. Shocking. Yeah. I guess it's the least I could do. The least I could do for that man. Summer?
Hello?
You're 20?
Yeah.
Yes. When he's done with this vacation, I will have spent more on him in this one vacation than he spent... from 8 years old to the time stepmom kicked me out of the house. Summer?
Yeah?
What's up there?
My roommate, he's like my best friend too.
Mm-hmm.
And accidentally had sex with him like a month ago.
How does one accident? He trip and fell and his penis fell into your...
No.
You've seen that Reese's peanut butter cup commercial?
You got vagina on my penis?
No, you got penis in my vagina.
Well, both, I guess. But, now he's, like, not even talking to me.
Well,
and,
he's not angry. He's just kind of freaked out.
I don't know. It's been, like, a month, and it's just, like, it was kind of, like, no strings attached sex, you know? He's been, like, my best friend since, like, elementary school, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And now we're both in college and working and stuff, and it's, like, I don't want to lose my best friend, and I don't want to lose my roommate. It's really hard to find a good roommate.
No, I don't believe any of it.
I love him to death, but...
Yes, you do. No, you're right about the love part. You like this guy.
Oh, I love him to death.
No.
You love him. You like him.
You like him. You got a crush on this guy.
No, I don't. I mean, I find him attractive, but he's almost... Yeah. Well, I don't want to get all incestuous and say he's like a brother, but...
Well, you're attracted to him. You love him to death, and you had sex with him. And he's a great guy and a great roommate.
Why wouldn't you?
Well, we were drinking.
You're into this guy. I'm telling you, you're into him.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
You broke her down, Anna. Way to go.
Thank you. Now, here's what's going on. The reason he's not talking to you is because he knows you're into him. And he's not into you that way. And he doesn't want this thing to move forward.
He doesn't want to hurt your feelings, and he doesn't want you to get the wrong idea. Both.
How do I know? Because, like, he's always, like, we're both single. And he's always been looking for, like,
Drew, an ideal hold on. Girl. Can we call the guy up?
Huh?
Can we call?
No, he works graveyard shifts, so.
So he's up, perfect. He's up working now.
Yeah, and I'm staying with my parents right now for the week because I'm kind of trying to get away from him for a while.
What kind of work does he do?
He does a busser, waiter.
So we couldn't reach him. We couldn't reach him at the restaurant.
No.
Does he work at a 24-hour place?
Yeah.
All right. Drew gave me the phone thing a couple of times, and I sort of ignored him. And the reason I did is because she's calling from D.C., and I figured it's 2 a.m. And
I'm not calling from D.C.
Oh, you're Washington. Seattle. I'm sorry.
Washington State.
Same difference.
Where does he work?
At Sherry's.
Jerry's.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, Jerry's? Like Jerry's Deli?
No, Sherry's.
Oh, Sherry's. Oh, okay. And it's open 24 hours.
Yeah.
He could step aside for a break.
No, I mean, he's going to be pissed at me if you guys call him because, you know, he won't even talk to me. He's not going to go on radio and talk
True.
To me.
True. I'm picturing us going down a long, gravelly road for nothing.
Yeah, you're right.
Thank you.
All right. Well, look, Adam is absolutely
correct. It's great. The show's broken my spirit to the point where I won't even try anything.
He's absolutely
sorry. Go ahead, Drew.
Adam is absolutely correct. You're into this guy. He senses it. He is anxious about that. He does value your friendship. He is now trying to figure out a way to salvage the friendship, not hurt your feelings, and not get this thing moving forward.
And you're pretending and you're trying to convince everybody, including yourself,
that
you're only into this guy as a friend with, oh, no, he's great. No, all I want is BS. You're into him.
I'm not pretending. I mean, I'm like a guy in the sense that, you know, it's like sex is sex. There's no sex
attached to it. Please.
I wasn't like, ooh, I love you. I just...
How dare you attempt to squash my theory? How dare you? I know you better than you know yourself. I am telling you, you are into this guy.
We're not even saying necessarily that the sex made that big a difference.
No.
You already were into
it. You're into this guy, and he knows it, and he's a little freaked out by it, and you're trying to play it off like you're not, but in your heart you are, and he feels that energy, and that's where the problem is.
But I don't have, like, this deep, lying love for him. I don't.
Well, why don't you leave
him? You know what? If you truly didn't,
this wouldn't matter.
Wouldn't it be big deal?
Yeah, this would be like, what's
wrong
with him?
Matters because he's my best friend.
No,
then BS. What are you worried about? He'd still be here. That whacked out roommate, my buddy.
He's your best friend. Yeah. He's your buddy. You guys live together. What are you scared you're not going to see him? What's he doing? Walking down the hall past you and not lifting his head up?
Yeah.
Why did women? We haven't gotten into this in a while, but women try to do this every once in a while. They try to act like a guy, and it just doesn't work. And when you start trying to break them down, you get little pieces.
Yeah.
Well, I am attracted to him, but he is a great guy. We have known each other. We live. But I'm so worried about the friendship. BS. Here's the thing about friendships, true friendships.
They take care of themselves, the friends, the friendship.
Yeah, friendship. Friendships, it's like an outdoor cat.
Yeah.
Just hanging out. Right. It can take care of itself.
That's absolutely right.
It can be gone for a couple of days. It'll come back.
Yeah.
No big
deal. Especially with guy. Now that's a guy friendship. Though.
Once in a while, it gets eaten by coyote,
bobcat in our case,
or bobcat. But yeah,
but girl relationships need some service.
Yeah, but they're not really friends. That's the whole thing.
They're compatriots.
They don't know it.
Comrades.
Yeah, barely that. Yeah, as soon as the revolution's over, they're going to be going at each other. They're just like Cubans.
Oh boy,
you see what I'm saying? All right, Shauna.
Yeah,
you're 18.
Yeah, I'm 18, and I'm going to New York University in about 2-3 days, actually.
Fantastic. Oh, how exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I've been in L.A., like, all my life, so I wonder if I could get your spiel, like, on New York.
Our spiel?
Yeah, you know, spiel.
We love that city.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't want to live there as an adult.
But she's going to college there. It's almost not even living there. You know?
I was about to get to that. But as an 18-year-old, it would have been a great experience and opportunity.
Cool.
Oh, yeah. I don't understand the guys in their 30s and 40s who want to live in the city.
Manhattan.
Yeah, that seems a little too much.
Yeah, too much.
Too much all the time. But
we go there. How many days a year do you think we spend there in the last 6 years?
Well, we could average about a couple of weeks there every year, and it's always exciting, and it's a great town, and there's lots to do, and there's lots of interesting people. And you're coming from Long Beach. And Long Beach doesn't really have any personality except for gangbangers and troublemakers.
And a race every year.
Yeah. This you're going from almost zero. And listen, don't anyone call up and try to defend Long Beach. I've been to Long Beach 1,000 times. It's a big, fat cultural zero.
Lived there for the last 3 years.
To a place. Anderson lives there. Anderson thinks it's great, so you know it sucks.
Go Anderson. Oh, sorry.
Oh, Shauna, I went to college in the East, and it's a little bit of a shock for California just to prepare for that. The weather, it's so different, and you just prepare for how different it is. And don't leave pieces of your life back here. Get your life going out there. Establish yourself there. That's your life for the next 4 years, and make it that.
No better age, no better time to go over there. So you're fine, baby. This is a golden opportunity.
And we'll still be there. We're there in the middle of the night. So you can still listen to it.
Can you get K-Rock over there?
No, well, it's on WNEW, right?
Okay.
Oh. It's on, I think it's on, our show's on at 11 over there.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think. Okay. All right, so we'll be there.
All right, great.
All right, baby, good times, good times.
All right, good times.
All right. Actually, I'm going there next week.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was nice, Drew. Kimberly.
Hello.
You're 18?
Yes, I am.
What's up?
I have, it's either a pimple or a cyst from my ear, like where my ear connects to my head.
Behind? Like behind the ear?
No, like, I guess where the earlobe connects to the head.
So down, right with, like right here, the crease where the earlobe.
Yeah.
All right.
And I've had cysts before.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, but I've had also pimples like this before, so.
Yeah, those are pretty nasty. Hot compresses in the meantime. Sometimes some antibiotics, ointment, and
What's a hot compress do?
It increases the flow of inflammatory cells into and out of that area so they can clean up the debris, and bacteria don't like the hot.
Yeah. So. I thought bacteria does like the hot.
Yeah, really not.
Well, some put it do. This way.
Well, why do you boil things and autoclave things? And
yeah, well, it doesn't like extreme hot, but it. Certainly, there's more crap under the garbage can in the summer than there is in the winter.
More crap.
Well, you know what I'm. Here's
that's
what
stuff,
I'm saying.
That's stuff that's stewing, though. That's
yeah.
Oh, that's organic material, you know, cooking.
That's what I'm saying. It's like during the summer, it's like one big crock pot outside. Nice. Big old stuff growing and hanging and jumping and moving and squirming.
How come we have not had a very, very positive reaction to the recent weather? You and I. We have weather.
I know, it's nice. We should, Drew.
We normally flip out. We're so happy when this weather hits. I'm not reacting to it the normal way for some reason.
You're jaded, man.
No, you know I don't trust it. I'm waiting for the heat to come. It's going to happen.
Well, I'll tell you, they give you the 5-day forecast, but I don't listen. You know why? Because I live my life a quarter mile at a time. You know what I'm saying?
I got it.
Right. I'm not sure how many days in advance a quarter mile is, but I'm guessing it's just a couple of maybe just a few minutes, actually. See what I'm saying, man?
I see.
So I live my life. Nathan?
Yes.
You're 21?
Yes.
What's up?
Hey, I can never seem to get a hard-on every time I'm about to have sex.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I wake up with hard-ons and things like that, and if I'm masturbating or something, after a while I can get it hard, but every time it comes to sex, I just doesn't like to go out. Like,
you're gay. How often does that happen?
Has it ever worked?
Yeah, I mean, I can still come. It just won't get completely hard.
So you've been able to actually have sex and penetrate?
Yes.
Does that something happens frequently for you?
No. I mean, no.
How many times have you had a failure?
Well, I've only had sex like 4 times. Well, tried 4 times, and once is like the only time I really succeeded. Because
okay.
What's up?
Are you on any medication?
I am not.
What do you do for a living?
I work at a car lot.
Car lot?
Yeah.
What do you do, wash the cars?
Yeah, pretty much.
Ooh, that's the lowest man on the car lot totem pole.
I know.
Do you have any medical problems?
I do not.
That's got to suck. And you're in Phoenix?
Oh, my God. Oh, is it an indoor car lot?
No, it's outside.
Oh.
You're just walking around. 122 degrees.
Yeah, it's not fun.
To be baked by the sun and waiting to die. That's all. I look at everyone living in Phoenix as just waiting to die.
Yeah, it's a good place to
yeah.
go.
Tucson, I look
to die, Adam,
Tucson,
yeah.
I look as already dead. Phoenix is waiting to die. And you just go around and wash the same car over and over again, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
What kind of dealership?
Toyota.
Toyota?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, it's not Hyundai. It's not yeah. Mercedes. You're right in the middle there, buddy.
Uh-huh.
Right where you belong at this age. All right, is anything wrong with you physically?
No. I mean, no. I've been, like, healthy my whole life.
Did he say he had an... how do you look?
How do I look?
Yeah. You nice-looking guy?
Yeah.
You ever, did you say he had an old lady, Drew?
No, I said it's had sex four times.
Yeah. How about getting a girlfriend and working it all out?
Okay.
Could you do that?
That's what you need, Nathan.
All right.
A relationship where if it doesn't work, somebody can still kind of reduce your anxiety and support you and be with you. And so you get to the point where things are starting to work on their own.
You meet any hot chicks on the lot?
Yeah, there's some hot ones.
You do?
They
do?
Summertime, yeah.
There's no chick mechanics, is there?
What's that?
Any chick mechanics that you work with? No.
No, and if so, they probably wouldn't be all that good looking.
No, I know. Did you see Gone in 60 Seconds?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, I had Angelina Jolie as like wheels. She worked on Ferraris.
Uh-huh.
Really, the biggest lie that movies ever tell is that hot chicks do anything, especially with cars. Angelina Jolie works on cars. First off, you'll never find a chick who works on cars. And if you do, she looks worse than the car.
You know, I was thinking about that.
She weighs more, I should say.
The preferences for kinds of interest that boys and girls have, males and females have. I was thinking about, for some reason, I was thinking about the human body and how if I bring up anything about blood or inside the human body or anything coming out of the human body when my wife and daughter are eating, mm-hmm. They're like, oh my God, I can't finish my meal now. And while the boys, they go from intrigued, interested, always on the verge of funny. You know what I mean? What's inside the body, what comes out of the body, it's always interesting, it's always almost funny or overtly funny.
Right.
And for a woman, it's disgusting or can't be discussed.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
Is your wife, she ever turn a wrench? Know anything about cars?
She does more around the house than I do.
I know, but that's because you're gay. But no chick. No decent-looking chick knows anything about cars. And let's face it. Hey, you know, we always worry. They worry in movies about smokers, people who are sort of being bad role models. I say making Angelina Jolie a Ferrari mechanic is a very bad and unrealistic role model for not only girls but boys.
Mm.
You think you're going to find one of them?
Oh, you see, the boys are going to go into mechanics so they can relate to one of those girls?
Super. I'm just saying that we expect through watching movies that super hot chicks know something, have a skill. If it's a James Bond movie, they're physicists. If it's a Nick Cage movie. And by the way, has Nick Cage, has something happened to him? Do you think he has a brain tumor?
Yes.
I mean, has the last eight movies he's done just been basically gay porn? Essentially gay porn? What happened to Nick Cage? What's going on?
I don't know.
Gone in 60 Seconds?
Scientology.
Oh, Scientology. That's right.
I thought it was John Woo's fault.
John Woo. What a genius. One of the greatest gay porn directors of our time. Broken Arrow. Gone in 60 Seconds. Did he do Gone in 60 Seconds?
No, but Windtalkers.
Windtalkers. Did he do Con Air?
Face Off.
Oh, Face Off. Whoa. gay, porn. Yeah, that's a great movie, that Face Off. We just take John Travolta's face and we put on Nick Cage's face, you see? And then it's confusing to everybody.
I see.
Yeah.
Apparently it had five endings. I left after the third one. I couldn't take any more endings. I just left after the third
ending.
What do
you mean it had five endings?
It just kept ending. It just kept being another ending. And then another one, and then I left.
I really wish that the American public wasn't so goddamn stupid and would just say that movies like that just suck. Royal ass.
You know people who like those?
Stupid people.
They like cake.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the people that like American cars, thick crust pizza, and cake. They like movies like Face Off and Broken Arrow and Con Air.
There's something kind of pure and innocent about those, all those things.
Yeah.
Naive.
That's right. Oh, what the hell's Nick Cage doing? But anyway, what was I saying? Hot chicks, they know nothing. And if you watch these movies, you think they know something. You watch any Bond movie, you watch any Nick Cage movie, there's a hot chick who has a skill, doesn't exist.
Oh, of course it exists.
I've never known a super hot chick that really knew anything. Mm-hmm.
Physicians and college professors.
And business
analysts.
Never seen it. There's attractive women who do stuff. Even that's surprising. You know, you find a woman who's attractive, and it's like, what? You're a physician? Or even you're a podiatrist, you're an attorney. Whoa, you're like a good 7.5, 8. What are you doing? You must have been ugly in college. I mean, that's surprising, but you don't see Angelina Jolie. Well, let me explain what Angelina Jolie does. That's how you know what the truth is. She plays mechanics. But in real life, what does she do?
Acts.
That's right. We'll take ourselves a little break. We'll be right back.
To buy Trojan, America's number one condom, the most trusted for over 80 years.
Right now, let's head back to Adam and Drew, shall we? It's Loveline in the Zone.
Hey, everybody. Drew. Me and Drew are having it. Career-oriented conversation right before the mics heat up before the beginning of the show. Then, of course, really, really what this show, I look at this show as
an interruption
between Drew and my conversation. Yeah. Drew and I would meet here every night at 10 o'clock to have a discussion until midnight and then speak on the cell phone on the way home. But then there's these little sections of the show that jump in, intervene, and interrupt our conversation.
Such a pain.
But Drew, during the commercial break, when you would assume we would finish our conversation, goes into the next room, does a little glad handing, then stands around and looks at some pictures for a couple minutes. Then as the music starts playing that's alerting him that the show's starting, comes walking back in to sit in the studio, and as the mic's heating up, finishes the conversation we were having.
Actually, so what do you think about that? Just finish it. Reinitiates
the conversation.
If I finished it, it'd be fine.
Yeah. So it's like, Drew, how many seconds would you say I would have had to respond to?
12.
Oh, no.
You had a good 12.
12?
Yeah, maybe 8.
You want me to tell you what 12 seconds feels like?
Maybe 8.
It's going to be bad radio. Ready? Go. 5.
What, 5 seconds.
Okay. So you gave me 5 seconds to continue the conversation we were having before the mics heated up. There you go. Hey, Jerry?
Yeah.
All right. What's up?
Okay. I've known this girl for about 3 weeks, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I let her drive my car. Now, she's only 14, and she got pulled over. And she got a ticket, and anyway, she's not living with her parents because she's from Oregon. And she came down here to live because I guess the parents are abusive or something. And so when that ends happening, it is now the guardian's real pissed at me.
Because you let her drive your car.
Yeah.
What kind of car do you have?
A Dodge Neon.
Neon.
Sweet.
Yeah. It gets me places.
Oh, and in Denver, too. It can really work that snow.
Yeah. That's a great... It's transportation. It gets you from point A to point not getting laid and back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I had to let her drive it.
What's the question here?
Anyway, he's real mad at me. He's banned me from going over to their house.
What's the question?
Is there like a way I could get in good with him now? Or
have you tried to meet him and get to know him a little bit?
Well, I was talking to her today, and she said that would probably just hurt things more.
Not necessarily. I mean, she's someone undoubtedly likes a good bit of drama.
Yeah.
Right? And so the advice she's going to give you is going to add, put fuel to the flames. I think trying to de-escalate things by going, meeting him, talking to him, apologizing, being contrite. You know what that word means?
Yeah.
Like, had
do? I don't know what it means. Nice,
I
sweet.
I just get it there.
All right.
Yeah, I've written a letter, actually, but
no.
I was going to send
yeah.
it to him. But
no, go see him.
Well, go see him. How about letting a little time pass?
That's okay too, but he's not going to be able to see her in the meantime. You know what I mean? This guy's really pissed. And
yeah, but you can't. Oh, there's no school or anything. Then she doesn't get out of the house. You can't meet her somewhere.
I think they're grounded now.
All right. I still say. Let it cool off a little.
And by the way, this girl is going to be a hell of a handful for him.
Ugh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Abuse of parents, under custody of a guardian, moved out of the area. Oh, boy.
People have no real grasp on what that is.
No, well, not at that. At 16.
No.
Could I have convinced you what that meant?
No.
No. Even now, it's hard, people. When you see a person who seems nice, looks nice, people see what they want to see in someone.
I tell you, I was at a maximum security prison 3 weeks ago,
right.
wanting to smuggle these guys out of here in my rectum.
Right.
It's like, hey, this sweetheart of a guy is playing the guitar, wearing some nice reading glasses. Seems nice.
Yeah. Killed three people.
whatever the folks did in there, they weren't getting out, and they weren't getting out ever.
You know, that was the point. I was thinking about something today, about how you nail people's jobs so clearly.
Yes.
I don't know what brought it up, but I thought, I wonder if there are sort of features, sort of constitutional, biological, psychological features that, what, attract us to certain jobs or let us tolerate certain jobs?
Well, yeah.
I mean, how do you pick up forklift driver?
Oh, well, that's just stupid. There's a lot of jobs that fall into the stupid category.
But people in every one of the, whatever the job is, there must be kind of a character to that person in that job. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Certain people would not be a forklift operator.
No.
But who would be?
I don't know, but I'll tell you when I talk to them.
Why?
I don't know how I know that, but I mean, I'm not right all the time. I just get a vibe every once in a while. Once in a while, I catch a guy who's working in a batting cage or something. It's like a crazy vibe that goes through me.
But to me, that means there's a pattern there. And what is that?
It's my genius, is what it is.
Aside from your genius, you've studied your genius for many years. I can't climb to those heights.
You're not looking hard enough. That's right.
I can't climb to those heights, so I have to make more mundane observations of my own.
I don't know. I can always tell. You know, you can tell when you're talking to cops because they sort of sound like criminals. And there's certain jobs where you just sort of tell who you're talking to. John?
Hey, how you doing?
53 years old.
How are you?
Wow.
What's up?
Listen, she's got this a little mixed up. I had 9 years sober.
9 years. Fantastic.
And I fell in love with a girl. What a doll. And I had picked up after 9 years. And
picked up using again?
Yeah.
What's the drug?
Alcohol.
All right.
And we tried to get back together, and I put 2 years together, and I went to a couple of rehabs and this and that. She went through torture. You know, she really...
Is she sober?
She's sober 9 years, yeah.
All right.
And we really love each other. You know, we always ended up with each other, and... I'm sober 7 months now, and, you know, what happens to her, she puts a Band-Aid on the grieving, you know, between me and her, and she's always come up to me and told me, you know, I love you, I'll miss you, I'll never, ever be able to live without you, but I can't live with you with active addiction, you know.
All right, so now you're sober.
And it's really, you know, that's right on the money.
All right, now you're sober, so what's happening?
And, yeah, I miss her.
What can we do to help?
Well, I don't want to lose her.
All right, where is she now?
She's with another guy.
Looks
like a troll.
It's too late, John. This is part of the consequences of your disease. She is with someone else.
Yeah, yeah.
That's it.
I have this gut feeling that she's going to come back.
Well, that's fine if you want to cling to that, but the fact is you got to focus on your sobriety. You shouldn't be engaging in anything new this year anyway.
Right.
Let your sobriety take hold, work it hard, and...
Well, what do you mean, new?
This would be a reinitiate. Don't make any change. Don't make change in that first year. You don't end relationships, don't start new ones, don't reinitiate old ones.
Even if it's warming over some old tang?
Even if it's warming over some old tang, yes. That's, in fact, the words that ran across my mind.
Is that in the book?
It's in the book, yeah. Bill W. is known to have said that, yeah. Don't warm over old tang. The first 12 months of sobriety.
So, but here's the thing too, John. You have a gut feeling she's going to come back?
Fine.
Either way, whether she comes back or not, you got to be sober.
And
right?
The reality is she has to be part of your disease, a big part of it. She's not getting better, and I suspect she's probably found another alcoholic or addict to sort of work on. And now the reason she is gone is the fact you are actually getting better probably this time.
But John, don't build her up too much. You focus on getting sober,
right?
And then we'll see if your gut, which I'm guessing is sizable, we'll see if that gut is right or not.
Well, she doesn't want you as a using addict. She doesn't want you as a sober one either.
Nick,
yeah,
you're 16.
Hey,
bisexual.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like afraid to tell my family about it.
Mm-hmm.
Because afraid like what they say or what they'll think about me.
Well, yeah. Why don't you wait till you're away at college or can support yourself by yourself and then tell them.
You go to college, I'll tell your folks. How about it?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I mean, my mom, we've had conversations about it before, just off like random conversation.
How do those go down? How do those get started?
Well, I don't, like, we'd be watching TV or something, and, like, there'd be gay people on it, or, like, bisexuals on it, and we'd just get on the subject, and then
let me stop you there. Bisexuals aren't portrayed on TV very often.
Yeah.
In fact, I can't think of a single.
No, but you know why? Bisexuals are like mulattoes. They're no good to TV. They're not black. They're not white.
But plenty of gay people on TV.
They're not gay. They're not straight. It's no good for TV. It's no good when you're creating a drama or even a comedy. There's nothing there. You're not one. You're not the other.
Mm-hmm.
Half of something is no good.
It could create a little drama or chaos. But anyway, the point is you were actually watching homosexuals on TV, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And that created some discussion about sexual orientation.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I saw a documentary, and I don't know if you've ever seen homosexuals in their natural habitat.
No.
Oh, my God.
Was this the primate feces thing?
Crazy. They were at a place called Oil Can Harry's.
Mm-hmm.
They were dancing to like a native ritual song. I think it was done by the village people. There was they had a glory hole and a conga line. It was eye-opening, Drew.
Hmm.
Eye-opening.
Nice.
So, Nick.
Yeah.
Have you ever been with a guy?
No. Uh-huh. I haven't.
No.
But, well, I mean, like, I'm attracted to them.
Are you?
Strongly.
Have you been with a girl?
You're gay.
Yeah.
Drew, please. You've been with a girl?
Yes.
And you enjoy women as well?
Oh, yeah.
And, you sure? I mean, you're attracted to guys, yet you've never been with one. Why don't you think you've been with one if you're so attracted
to
one?
Well, I mean, I'm just starting high school this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, mm-hmm. I mean, there were, like, a lot of people, like, don't open up, like, around, like, their peers and stuff, because they're, like, afraid of, like...
Yeah.
Yeah. Right,
which is realistic.
And by the way, you're starting high school at 16?
Yeah, I'll be a sophomore.
All right.
Mm-hmm. And freshmen are still junior high in my school.
When was your birthday?
86.
No, what month?
November.
So you're a year behind? Are
you 16 now?
I'll be 16 in a couple of days.
Oh. Okay.
In November, I'm sorry.
Okay. That's what screwed everything up for us. The screen says 16.
Yeah.
We thought you were going to be 17, and that would have been terribly old to start high school.
Yeah.
All right there, buddy boy. Look, don't get into it with your parents.
Okay.
I know people have this sort of truth is for all nonsense BS, but... they don't need to know.
The only time
it's
we
not
find,
even really the right to know.
The only time we find people standing up at the dinner table under the age of 18 to talk about their sexual orientation is when they have a score to settle. They're angry.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's the only time that happens.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's adolescents don't talk to their parents about their heterosexual experiences either.
Look, I don't think you should talk to your parents after your 15th birthday. I've something I've always stuck by. And I'm on a roll now.
Oh, I mean, you've made it since you were 15?
23 years.
Nice.
23 years. Yeah, you know, I don't know, Drew, what did you talk to your parents about? I mean, you must have just had endless conversations about college and grades, right?
Yes.
Is that all you guys talked about?
Yes.
Your dad saying you could do a little bit better in trig?
I don't really remember, but yeah, okay.
Really? Is your dad, like Drew's dad was a doctor. Did your dad give you all kinds of doctorisms about what it's going to be like and you're going to have to?
No.
None of that stuff?
Not that I recall, no.
He wasn't that kind of guy?
No.
But they did talk to you about getting your grades in order?
Yeah.
And they'd say to you stuff like, how's this going or what's this going or have you applied here or what about that?
Yeah.
Those kind of discussions. And that's probably the bulk of your discussions?
Yeah.
That and traveling places?
No, we didn't travel.
But what about discussion of travel?
Sure, lots of that.
Lots of that? and family members you can give a rat's ass about.
Lots of discussion about that.
Yeah. I spend the bulk of my time talking to my family about people that they know that I don't know.
Yeah.
That's the Mandels. Trudy and Jules. Trudy went to Spain.
Did they ever ask you that?
Trudy does pottery. She's quite gifted. Yeah, that's great. Here, let me just ask you a question. You think the Mandels sit around and discuss my potential as an artist?
Huh.
I'm not so sure they do.
Do they have kids, any of these people?
Yeah.
And those kids were great to hang around?
We hung around. First off, you grow up. I grew up with a bunch of people I thought were my aunts, my uncles, and stuff like that. I have no relation to these people at all. They just think it's their friends.
Yeah,
it's like your grandparents' friends, yeah. Your parents' friends. Thank God my parents were such colossal dorks that they had almost zero social life and zero friends. I mean, they really... My mom had a couple of, like, crazy, whacked-out, hippie nut jobs that flew around the house like buzzards circling a dead yak out in the Serengeti once in a while, but that was about it. Mm. Now, my grandparents are the ones that had all these kooky friends.
Mm. Did they have kids?
The Mandels had Rico, Renee, and Mimi.
Here's the great thing about those relations. I'm sure a lot of time and energy was put into discussing whether you enjoyed spending time with those kids.
Yes, and I didn't. They were all big husky kids that we had nothing. Here, let me give you an idea of nice enough people, but let me give you an idea of the kid who was my age. His name was Renee. A, his name was Renee. B, he was a violinist.
Ooh.
He now plays with the L.A. Chamber Orchestra.
Was he the guy that's on the side of the building
in
downtown Los Angeles?
Yes. He is that big in real life, too. He was when he was in the sixth grade. He was that big. And number three, when he's not playing the concert violin, he's boning up on his French.
Oh, boy.
Okay. Now, I'm 11.
Trying to master English.
And my whole thing is, my whole goal to life is to ride a wheelie one whole block on my dirt bike and see who I can kill with a dirt clod.
Yes, yes.
That's all I want to do in life. And this guy's boning up on French and playing the fiddle. Okay? So, zero really interest to talk about. Oh, you take a couple 11-year-olds and stuff them in the same room that can keep each other occupied, but it's not exactly kindred spirits, you know? And the Mandels were like this whacked-out family that was like half Jewish and half French. So, Jules, the main dad, would always speak to the kids in French.
Oh, boy.
So it's like, and he'd do it when he was mad. So you'd be sitting there, and he'd lean on and go, and I'm just sitting there like, ugh. And I'm wearing a goddamn yarmulke. Because this is what Jews do. Jews force you to wear a yarmulke when you eat at their house, because you'd go over there like, we're going to the Mandels for the Seder. Ugh. Put the yarmulke, but it's a crappy paper yarmulke, and you've got that bad 70s hair, and you don't even know what's on. You end up walking around 2 weeks with a goddamn paper yarmulke on your head. You're just sitting there at the table, and when Jules isn't speaking French, he's speaking Yiddish, you know, and he's doing the Seder, you know, and it's like, I'm 9 and a half. It's like, oh, Christ, could I please give me that goddamn brisket? I'll kill myself with it. I'll shove that. These goofballs. Not a kid. Nobody. Nobody had a dirt bike. Nobody had a German Shepherd. Nobody had a swimming pool. Nobody had anything. It was just, we're going over the Mandels. You can put a paper yarmulke on and listen to Jules speak French and Yiddish for 4 hours. Meanwhile, all the food just gets cold. You just sit there staring at a steaming piece of brisket and watching it turn to ice while Jules waxes on about Elijah. and the bitter herbs and stuff. I didn't even know what the F he was talking about. And no novelty. Yiddish is like a novelty. It's like it's a comedic language.
It was actually Hebrew, I suspect.
Whatever.
Yeah. Okay.
Drew, watch. I'll tell you exactly what it sounded like. You start rambling on in French, and I'll do my Hebrew, and I'll tell you exactly. This is what the Seder sounded like.
Le français sans bacon.
La high, la high, I'm la high, I'm la high, I'm la high. That's what it sounded like, just sitting there for 4 hours. This was my childhood. All right, let's take a little break. I promise to take more calls when we come back.
Loveline. Loveline will be right back. So get your problems ready.
This is Adam Carolla.
This is Dr. Drew. You're listening to 100.5
The Zone. Loveline, I'm Adam. That's Drew. Let's get back to the phones, Drew.
Let's go.
Rick?
Yes, how you guys doing?
29, dandy buddy. What can we do you for tonight?
Oh, well, first off, you haven't even mentioned your high school reunion coming up.
My high school reunion is coming up on Saturday.
How does Rick know about this?
I don't know. I mentioned it a time or two.
You going to go to it?
Yeah.
I know one of the organizers.
Oh, are you?
Yes. Well, no, I'm not involved, but one of my friends is one of the organizers.
Where is it going to be?
Universal.
Okay.
I don't care if people show up.
Oh, I want to go. I want to see this.
Let me ask you guys this for a second. They asked me to host something, and I just said, no disrespect, but I really don't want to do that. I don't want to come back as the guy who's the host guy. I just like to meet old people and, light a cigar with some $50 bills, do a rail of Coke, bang a couple of cheerleaders who are now fat, and hop back in the stretch SUV.
I've got to see this. I have to see. These people are all... I've got to get the vibe. I've got to see who these people are.
They're just stupid people from
I've
the
I've got to come. You've got to tell me where this is.
Saturday.
It's this Saturday.
Yeah. All right, anyway.
All right, here's the scoop. This is the thing that's kind of freaking me out. My girlfriend of a year and a couple of months, her brother just came in town for just the last 2 days. He's leaving back to Chicago tomorrow. And he rented a hotel with his wife literally two blocks away from where she lives. So it's not like they're too far away. But she is actually spending the last two nights in the hotel with them, sleeping in between her brother and sister-in-law, kind of like three in a row.
How old is she?
She's 27.
And how old are these the couple?
Her brother's 39. And I would imagine the wife would also be, somewhere
bizarre.
Right there. Well, here's the one thing that only throws me. She does see him a couple times a year. She flies to Chicago. The only thing that I can kind of see is her father, or their father, passed away when she was younger. So I'm thinking, is this kind of like her father that she didn't have?
And he's 10 years older than she is.
12 years.
12 years older. Yeah, that is undoubtedly the kind of thing that went on for her.
This is very weird.
Even if it were, let's say it was her father that she was sleeping between her father and mother at age 29, that would be bizarre, inappropriate, horrible boundaries. And yeah,
she's not a dumb person. She's extremely bright. Her brother is actually a emergency room doctor. I mean, it's not, she's not coming from
Why don't you appeal to him?
Here's the question.
Well, I just found out about it tonight, and he's obviously he's leaving tomorrow morning at a 7 o'clock flight.
Rick,
she happened to mention when I called.
Rick,
I figured she's just visiting. She's got another room. Yeah,
Rick, settle in, buddy.
Go ahead.
Number one, what are they serving at the reunion? Is it going to be like veal, or do we get a choice between like a fish?
Oh, you're not
going
to
meat?
You know what? I turned down the invitation, but I've got no idea. I can find out for you.
You were going to go?
No, my friend invited me, but another friend of mine invited. A friend of 12 years invited me.
Hold on, you invite people to reunions?
No, that's part of the organizing. Yeah, we're good friends. That's a totally different issue. Has nothing.
Hey, now I'm pissed off that you didn't invite me.
What do you mean? Why would you go to some other reunion that wasn't even a school you went to?
I've been living with this. I've been hearing this for 10 years.
Okay, Drew, I'm done.
Well,
Rick, here's the thing. Does she do anything else in life that's peculiar, creepy, or strange?
Well, here's the one issue. We've been going out for a little over a year and a few months. The one thing that she is, she's very, very close to getting her hours for child, family, marriage, council, whatever it is. But she's given up on it. But basically the last year, the program that she was working for at one of the major hospitals shut down. And for the last year or so, she's basically just been a nanny to her niece, to her other brother's child. And she works with me every now and then. I mean, she'll come out and, you know, kind of ride shotgun and help me out, and I appreciate it. You know, I look forward to it.
Wait a minute. What do you do?
I'm a plumbing contractor.
Ride shotgun.
Well, what I mean by that is shotgun. She just rides around with me in the truck.
All right.
She does some of the bookkeeping, that kind of stuff.
She doesn't sweat any pipes?
No, but she does pull pipe.
All right.
Yeah, and I don't mean mine. Well,
oh.
All right.
Don't mean that.
Okay, listen. Here's the thing. I'll give everyone one weirdo thing to do. And I granted this thing of sleeping in between the brother and sister-in-law. And what the hell's up with the sister-in-law?
Yeah.
That's the real question that needs to be answered. I'll give someone one weirdo thing to do once a year. And if it doesn't seem to affect other parts of their life, I'll let them slide
when
on.
When did that ever happen?
Never.
Yeah.
But he couldn't come up with anything other than sort of dropping out of nursing school.
No, MFCC's, Married Families Counseling, and she should absolutely, A, know that this is inappropriate behavior. B, it's 1,000 hours of clinical, and she was down to her last year, almost there, and then stops?
Well, people do that all the time. That doesn't...
No.
And they can restart. That doesn't mean... That's not bizarre behavior.
Yeah.
That's not wearing your cat on your head.
All right.
And marching in the lesbian parade.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
Okay. Still, we know something's horribly wrong with her, and Rick's nowhere close to it, and Rick's a calculated guy, and something's up, and who cares?
Okay.
Don't get her pregnant. And thanks for not coming to my reunion.
David, 34.
Hi. Good to talk to you guys. Listen, I live in Las Vegas, and I can tell you that prostitution is legal in every county in Nevada except for Clark County, which is Las Vegas, Henderson, Boulder City are the major cities in here. Okay. The girls do get screened. I believe they get a weekly blood test.
Well, how many counties are there? How many?
I think there's like 10 or 11.
10 counties in the entire state.
Yeah, and
think about that.
In every county but Clark County.
Rhode Island has more counties.
But aren't all the ranches in one place?
No, they're spread out. There's some, like you mentioned, Pahrump, which is probably the closest one to Las Vegas. But there's brothels and whorehouses all the way up and down, like in Ely and all the other counties. As a matter of fact, the largest one in the state of Nevada, which was the Mustang Ranch outside of Reno, was actually operated by the federal government for a number of years to pay back the back taxes the owner never paid.
Wow. That's
beautiful.
Yeah, it's nice. David, we got a few seconds left here. What's going on?
I'm a single father. I have a 6-year-old daughter, and I was wondering, when is it going to be okay to introduce her to somebody I'm dating?
When you really believe they're going to be around for a while.
Okay.
That's otherwise, I would not involve her in those relationships.
I haven't yet, you know, but I haven't really found anybody I've been very serious about.
And she will, you know, it would be very helpful to her to have some female relationships that are,
well,
again.
My in-laws, my wife's parents, have been very involved in her life since the day she was born.
Right. The people.
My wife's cousin moved in with us while she's going to college. So she does have a lot of female.
All right. That's what's important. Don't involve her in your relationships till they're going to be a part of her life permanently.
All right. We'll be back.
You know what I'm saying out there?
Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back on Loveline. Loveline. We'll be right back on 100.5 The Zone.
Oh, man, that was good. That was a great show, Drew. It really feels satisfying to help the kids this way.
I'm just thinking cranberries.
Yep. I'm going to head in the kitchen and get myself some pumpkin pie because, you know, when it's cold and it's been in the fridge and you don't have to use a fork, you just eat it with your hand because
you
it
know
holds
what,
up.
You know what? It's still Thanksgiving right now, so you can have it hot.
All right. All right.
Good
all
time.
All right. Thank you all for listening. Hope you had a great Thanksgiving. Until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.